Alright guys, this is Mr. TARDIS and welcome to Mr. TARDIS Reviews. Now last time I reviewed the penultimate episode of Doctor Who Series 1, Bad Wolf, and now I'm reviewing The Parting of the Ways. But because the last episode ended with a spectacular cliffhanger, I'm not going to waste any time and just dive straight into this review. I know you've been waiting for it. So, cue the opening credits. The Parting of the Ways starts with a brief preview of what happened in the previous episode, as is par for the course with two-part episodes this season. Stories like World War III and The Doctor Dances opened with a brief recap on how the previous episode played out, just as a refresher for the audience.
Deadly to humans, maybe.
Go to your room!
Okay, let's see what happens. How is the Doctor and co going to get out of this one?
You will obey or she will be exterminated.
Rose?
Yes, Doctor?
I'm coming to get you.
Okay, that's clever.
It's such a tiny detail, but whoever edited that just knew that dedicated viewers would be on the edge of their seats wanting to know what happens next, so the decision to prolong the wait just a little bit is so hilariously insidious in a very innocent way. But anyway, after the credits we have Rose, still in Dalek custody, being questioned as to what will the Doctor's next actions be, and those are to fly headlong to the Dalek ship in his TARDIS while having missiles fired at him. This is a great cinematic opening, and in 2005 this was about as big as British television got. It also helps to get the story off to an action-packed start to appease viewers who want spectacle before the story becomes a lot more personal later on. So, after the loud action-soaked opening, it turns very quiet as the Doctor and Jack have rescued Rose and are left with a destroyed Dalek in the console room.
I was there. The war between the Daleks and the Time Lords, with the whole of creation at stake. My people were destroyed, but they took the Daleks with them. I almost thought it was worth it. Now it turns out they died for nothing.
I'm going to say this so many times in this review, so I'll apologise now for being repetitive, but Christopher Eccleston really is amazing in this episode.
I'll talk about specific instances later, but Eccleston owns this episode. It's immensely fitting, seeing as though it's his last, but not only does he nail the dialogue, but there are so many instances where his face says more than words ever could.
There's thousands of them now. We could hardly stop one.
And then we're reminded of the imminent threat. Thanks to episode 6, Dalek, which was an amazing episode, we know that just one of these things is capable of destroying all life on Earth. And we weren't just told how dangerous they are, we know it, we saw it firsthand. This makes them incredibly fitting villains for the series finale. But now, there's literally 500,000 of them. So, what will the Doctor do? Run right out of the door and face them.
Is that it? Useless. Null point.
I'm sure he knew that he would be safe and that's why he went out the way he did, but what if the plan backfired? What if the force field just stopped working for that moment?
Fortunately though, that doesn't happen, and the Doctor faces the Daleks, and his oncoming storm speech is just impeccable. You get the sense that the Doctor has wanted to say this for a long time, almost like he's sort of glad that the Daleks didn't die in the Time War, because he wants to give this speech and let them know who is boss. But then...
How did you survive the Time War?
They survived through me.
Oh,
knows. Captain, this is the Emperor of the Daleks.
The Dalek Emperor. This is a gorgeously designed creation. The concept art basically just showed off a 200-foot-tall Dalek stuck to the ground, but this is a much better concept. The legs make it feel like it's rooted to the very heart of the mothership. The eye stalk and the bumps on the side give it a Dalek feel, but its design is unique enough to distinguish itself from the rest, and the pièce de résistance is the Dalek in the middle. It can be easy to forget sometimes, but the Daleks are creatures. They're not robots. They're little blobs inside indestructible tanks, and having the Emperor blob on display serves as a constant reminder, even if it's just a visual one, that these are sentient evil creatures.
Nicholas Briggs voices the Daleks in this series, and he also voices the Emperor in this episode, and it's really clever how they've done it. Nicholas Briggs's voice is set at a much lower and booming register than the other Daleks, but his inflections and his sentence structures are exactly the same.
The Emperor explains that this new army of Daleks were created through converting the humans taken from the game shows on Satellite 5, which makes the Daleks half-human. Fans of the Daleks will know that, well, they hate anything that isn't Dalek, so the idea of them being created from human remains just doesn't really fit with their character. But then...
Hiding in silence for hundreds of years, that's enough to drive anyone mad. But it's worse than that. Driven mad by your own flesh. The stink of humanity. You hate your own existence. And that makes them more deadly than ever.
It all fits perfectly into place. We have a threatening, powerful, hateful, and self-loathing army to fight, and that is simply terrifying.
I reached into the dirt and made new life. I am the god of all Daleks.
And I bring you
fire! I'll take you to burn.
You're insane.
While John Barrowman and Billie Piper are in this scene, this is Eccleston's show. But to be honest, I wasn't really a big fan of how some of his lines were written and delivered.
No good stood round here chin-wagging. Human race, you'd gossip all day. Daleks have got the answers.
Let's go meet the neighbours.
Useless. Null point. Okie doke. So, where were we?
Stay where you are. Exterminate.
It seemed to almost devalue the threat that our protagonists were facing against. If they can't take them seriously, why should the audience? But then, as the Doctor goes to leave, the Daleks attempt to destroy the TARDIS again, but it's safe inside the shield. But the Doctor has his head placed against the door, and now we get it. The cocky attitude, the invincible demeanour, it was all just an act. In this moment, the Doctor's defiance is completely stripped away. He literally has no advantage in this fight.
We're not even 10 minutes into this episode, and it's already masterful television. But now let's talk about the Doctor, now that the main conflict has been revealed.
This is Eccleston's swan song, and thankfully this episode is pretty much all about him.
But Mr. Trilbee TARDIS, wasn't it Rose who saved the day in the end? Well, yes and no.
But I'm getting ahead of myself. The Doctor comes up with a plan to wipe out the Daleks with a Delta Wave. It's pretty much science mumbo-jumbo, it's a plot device, and he asks Rose to help. But when it seems like all hope is lost, he has his Eureka moment.
Tyler, you're a genius! We can do it!
If I use the TARDIS to cross my own timeline...
Yes!
Maury Gold's music starts to swell, the Doctor is so happy and energetic, and he instructs Rose to stay inside the TARDIS and hold a button down. He then steps outside. Then the music stops. The manic energy dissipates. He then turns to face the TARDIS. And in this moment, all 900 years are on Eccleston's face. He lifts his screwdriver, presses the button, and sends Rose home. He knows that if she stays, she will die, and he cannot let that happen.
This is Emergency Program 1. Rose, now listen. This is important. If this message is activated, then it can only mean one thing. We must be in danger, and I mean fatal. I'm dead or about to die any second with no chance of escape.
No.
And that's okay. Hope it's a good death. But I promise to look after you, and that's what I'm doing. The TARDIS is taking you home.
This is such a simple but affecting scene. It's pretty much the Doctor bluntly stating that he won't be surviving, and that the TARDIS will be abandoned, and that Rose should live on without him. And that final head turn.
Have a good life. Do that for me, Rose. Have a fantastic life.
It's almost like the Doctor knows that she's there somehow, and with a final, comforting smile, he fades away.
Oh, don't cry, Mr. TARDIS. Don't cry.
So if the Doctor is giving up, then why is he the hero of the story?
It was a better life. And I don't mean all the travelling and seeing aliens and spaceships and things that don't matter. The Doctor showed me a better way of living your life. You know he showed you too. That you don't just give up. You don't just let things happen. You make a stand. You say no. You have the guts to do what's right when everyone else just runs away and I can't.
Now, you may not realise it, but this speech is pretty much the entire point of Doctor Who Series 1. Let me explain.
Looking back on all 10 stories, it's 13 episodes, but because of the two-parters, it's pretty much 10 stories. What has the Ninth Doctor actually done? After the events of the Time War, he's a broken man. He is not the same Doctor from the classic series. In Rose, Rose saved the day. In The End of the World, Jade hugely helped the Doctor save the day. In The Unquiet Dead, Gwyneth made the sacrifice. In World War III, it's Mickey and Harriet Jones who have the hard decisions. In Dalek, it's Rose again. In The Long Game, it's Kathika. The Doctor got kidnapped in that story. In Father's Day, it's Peter Tyler after the Doctor dies. In The Doctor Dances, Nancy accepts responsibility for her child. In Boomtown, the episode kind of cheated because no one had to decide anything, but you get my point.
Now, all of those supporting characters in Doctor Who Series 1, with their different genders, their different colours, their different creeds, their different time zones, their different cultures, what did they all have in common? They were all influenced by the Doctor.
Before they all met the Doctor, these people were uninterested or unable to save the world or the conflict in question. But then, the Doctor drops into their lives and makes them better people. Yes, there were some casualties, but with their sacrifices, they helped to make the universe a better place. And this is the personification of the Ninth Doctor. He helps make people better. He literally travels across time and space, saving the universe one person at a time. And that is simply incredible in terms of narrative storytelling and story arcs over the course of a whole series. The whole bad wolf motif? No, that was not the theme of Series 1. It was all about ordinary people making the universe a better place. It's beautifully told across 13 episodes, and that comes to a conclusion here, and it is almost flawless.
Now, there's one teeny tiny problem with all of this, and that's the fact that he didn't make Rose Tyler a better person.
Sure, the Doctor took someone who worked in a shop and turned her into someone who is capable of saving the universe, but she's still a terrible human being. I can't be too critical because it's not as if Russell T. Davies intended this to be the meaning. He is completely in love with Rose. Also, this is only in terms of her personality. It's the Doctor's influence on Rose over the past 13 episodes that caused her to go back and save him in the end and save the universe. This also extends to Mickey and Jackie. Jackie started the series as someone always gossiping on the phone, and she wasn't special in any way, but she helped save the world in World War III, and she brings Rose the truck later on in this episode to get back the Doctor. And Mickey was a complete coward who let people walk all over him in the beginning, and now, well, he's bloody awesome. Back to Eccleston, though. He is simply incredible in every moment he is on screen. Honestly, hyperbole does not exist here. While he's great with the dialogue, there's just so much in his face and behind those eyes. Like I said before, there are moments when all 900 years are on his face, clear as day, and it's just a spectacular performance. As for Billie Piper as Rose, she is incredible as well.
But Mr. Trilbee TARDIS, I thought you hated Rose Tyler. Yeah, I do. But I love Billie Piper.
Just to clarify, my hatred for Rose has never come from Billie, and over the past 13 episodes, she has been nothing short of extraordinary. The way she tries to stop the TARDIS from leaving, when she reminds Jackie of what her father would have done, and when she gives her speech in the chip shop, these are all fantastic performances. Unfortunately, though, there are some really bitchy moments that I just cannot overlook here. Okay, so early on when Linda says...
And this place can transmit a massive wave, wipe out the Daleks!
Well, get started, then do it then!
Just look at Rose's reaction. Why? Because she wasn't the one to tell the Doctor to start working? She's really going to be pissed off over something as tiny as that? And the scene where Linda and the Doctor shake hands, look at her in the background. That is a look of sheer disgust. And it's at a handshake. It's such a small moment, but it makes me wonder what we as the audience are meant to feel about Linda. Objectively, she's been a great non-companion. But what were the intentions of Russell T. Davies? He stated that he sees Rose as the perfect companion who can do no wrong. She's pretty much a Mary Sue, so of course she's the one who the audience members are meant to trust. So when she looks at Linda in that way, how are we supposed to feel? Some audience members who love Rose may subliminally pick up on this and feel the same way she does about Linda, which is just terrible. Or, I don't know, maybe I'm just overthinking things.
The most annoying thing about those two examples is that I don't know who to blame for those. I've got a copy of Doctor Who The Shooting Scripts, which is a great book, by the way. If you're interested in getting into writing for TV or film or whatever, and you like Doctor Who, I'm assuming you like it because you're watching this review, then be sure to pick up a copy of this, get it used for really cheap or whatever, and be sure to watch the episodes while reading this, because it helps you teaches you to format and write scripts. It's just a great learning tool. But anyway, this has the 13 scripts from Doctor Who Series 1, and for those scenes with Rose and Linda, It doesn't mention any of Rose's reactions at all. So was it something that Russell T. Davies told Billie Piper to do, or was it director Joe Ahern's instructions to Billie to react like that, or was Billie Piper just improvising on set? I just don't know where to aim my criticisms at.
It also does get frustrating when the script keeps telling us how amazing Rose is when she does nothing to prove it.
Rose, you are worth fighting for.
Well, I'm just too good.
Wrong!
And don't even get me started on how she treats Mickey here. In this scene, he's opening up to her, and she just ignores him.
You can't spend the rest of your life thinking about the Doctor.
How do I forget him?
You gotta start living your own life. You know, a proper life like the kind he's never had. The sort of life that you could have with me.
I understand that she gets distracted by the bad wolf signals, but she still never responds or brings it up later, and this could be her very worst moment in the entire series.
Rose,
If
you go back, you're gonna die.
That's a risk I've got to take. Because there's nothing left for me here.
Nothing?
No.
Okay, Rose, I understand, okay? I get it. You're frustrated because the Doctor sent you home and you want to help and you don't think you'll ever see him again. I get it. You're upset, you're annoyed, you're not thinking clearly, but did you have to say the word nothing in that exact tone of voice? Did you have to say it in that voice to someone who has pretty much worshipped the ground you've walked on for 13 episodes? To someone who, yes, he's a bit of an idiot, he's a bit of a klutz, but he's nice, he's kind, he respects you. And why did you have to shoot him down in such a reprehensible and thoughtless way?
As for Captain Jack Harkness, he has been around for only 5 episodes, but he has definitely had the biggest change in his personality. He started off as a cowardly con man, the type of guy who would run away from any trouble and was just in it for his own selfish reasons. But now, once again influenced by the Doctor, he tries to encourage others to follow him on a suicide mission to face the Daleks. And he knows he can't win, but he's willing to give his life if it will give the Doctor just one more minute to prepare the Delta Wave. Whether that's bravery or stupidity, it's at least honest. He also plays a good role here on a narrative level. The Doctor is not going to do any of the shooting or fighting, and he sure as hell isn't going to let Rose do it, so the story requires someone like Jack to get his hands dirty. He's able to get others to join him, but he's still hopeless. But he will gladly die for the Doctor.
Wish I'd never met you, Doctor. I was much better off as a coward. See you in hell.
And in the end, he is the last man standing, fighting off the Daleks with a machine gun until he's cornered firing a tiny handgun. He knows he is a dead man, but he will fight to the last, and he dies. He's shot dead, alone in the corridor. What works about this death is that he dies the same way everyone else dies. He didn't get a final speech or a final moment of glory. He didn't suicide bomb the enemies to death. He didn't even take any of them out with him. He just died at the hands of the Daleks and was, in the end, as helpless as the rest, even though he was a main character. Another victim is Linda, played brilliantly by Jo Joyner. I love how loyal she is to the Doctor and how she isn't portrayed as someone who was ever going to save the day or even survive the story. Even though she got quite a bit of screen time, she was just another body at the end. Her and the Doctor's goodbye was really charming as they couldn't decide on a kiss or a hug, so they just shook hands instead. She becomes the onlooker of the story as she is tucked safely away on the observation deck, letting the audience know what's happening concerning the Dalek's assault. But even being in that safe position cannot save her.
Human female detected.
They found me.
You'll be all right, Linda. That side of the station's reinforced against meteors.
I hope so. You know what they say about Earth workmanship.
This is perfectly directed by director Joe Ahern. It's literally like something out of a horror film. The way the music builds and Linda slowly turns around, she reacts to something off screen, and then we, the audience, finally see it. The Daleks slowly rise up, we see their dome lights light up for their iconic four-syllable battle cry, and then... and the Doctor's reaction to her death. There's no dialogue, but my heart just weeps for him. The main characters aren't safe here, and what a fitting way to make the Daleks a legitimate threat. Speaking of the Daleks, they are on top form here. Seriously, this could be the best that the Daleks have ever been, despite the fact that the story isn't really about them. But they're still amazing. The director Joe Ahern directed the episode Dalek, so he has experience working with them, and he makes them incredibly scary and threatening. Not only are the Daleks going to kick ass, but they've brought a choir with them.
This is it, ladies and gentlemen, we are at war.
There are some great shots here, but not just the use of CGI, which is able to give the audience hundreds of Daleks on screen at once, but the way they're shot when they're on their rampage individually. At first, it seems like the humans might have a chance.
The guards had guns with ballistic bullets, that's enough to blow a Dalek wide open.
That's a great callback to the classic series, by the way, but it becomes apparent that with the Daleks' force fields, they might as well be playing a video game where the enemy has all the cheats on. Although it does bring to mind, how did they take out an Ice Stalk if they have a force field that melts the bullets? Anyway, Ahern shoots the Daleks brilliantly. For example, I love the corridor scene, how we see the shadow first, then the Dalek comes into view, and how it almost seems like the camera is retreating and cowering beneath them. It helps to put the audience in the shoes of the victims. And there's one scene that sticks out to me the most, and that's when the Daleks go to Floor Zero. Hey, where's that choir coming from? Here's the context. Because of science, the Daleks can only penetrate the station at level 494, and they have to get to floor 500 to stop the Doctor. Going up to floor 500 is their goal, but instead, a group of them travel to floor 0 and exterminate all of the humans down there.
Ha!
Floor Zero. They killed them all.
Now, there was no need for them to go to Floor Zero. All the humans down there were unarmed and helpless. They were offered to be a part of the fight and they turned it down. But the Daleks killed them anyway. Why? Just because they detected that there were about 30 or 40 life forms on Floor Zero that weren't Dalek. They kill all of the humans as they plead for their lives. It's so dark, it's so ruthless, but it's so utterly Dalek. Flash forward 8 years later, and Rory is able to power slide across a room full of Daleks, and there's no tension and no danger for him. Oh, how times have changed.
I don't know if I've ever mentioned this before, but isn't Asylum of the Daleks freaking terrible?
The Daleks start to bomb entire continents, and while it's really dark, the limitations of a TV show budget don't really allow us to see the full effect of it. But also, there are some really funny moments in the story as well, such as this absolute gem.
Advance guard have made
it to 495.
Jack, how we doing?
495 should be good. I like 495.
Identify yourself!
You are the weakest link. Goodbye.
Yes!
You are the weakest link.
Now that's a great bit of humour in an otherwise dark story.
That's one thing Russell T. Davies has always been great at, finding the humanity in his stories. For example, the male and female operator have a suggested romance. It helps to humanise these two expendable characters, even though it might just be a bit superfluous. So Jack and Linda and everyone else on Satellite 5 have been killed except for the Doctor. The Daleks surround him, but the Delta Wave is ready.
You really want to think about this. Because if I activate the signal, every living creature dies.
I am immortal.
Do you want to put that to the test?
I want to see you become like me. Hail the Doctor, the Great Exterminator!
Like Rose's chip speech, this is another conclusion to the Doctor's 13-episode character arc. In the Time War, he killed the Time Lords and the Daleks. He pushed the button that took them both down. But this time, he's faced with the same dilemma, except it's the Daleks and the humans. Does he kill the Daleks and everyone on Earth, or does he let the Daleks win? This is set up really well in the context of the story.
The Delta Wave must kill every living thing in its path, with no distinction between human and Dalek. All things will die by your hand.
Doctor, the range of this transmitter covers the entire Earth.
Of course it does. It's meant to broadcast signals to all over the Earth, so it makes sense that that is where the Delta Wave would go. And the moral quandary itself is simply good storytelling. The Doctor versus the Daleks is already a compelling narrative, but over the course of the story there's this Delta Wave element, being able to destroy the humans, and it helps to stack the odds further against our hero. So the Doctor is in the same position he was in at the end of the Time War, a decision that mirrors his dilemma in Genesis of the Daleks. Does he have the right? But he decides he doesn't. He simply cannot commit double genocide again. He would rather keep his morals and his principles than become known as the Great Exterminator. But just as he accepts his death, Rose appears in the TARDIS. But how did she get there? Well, she recognised the phrase bad wolf in the past and discovered that it's a link and a message for her to go back and save him. To be honest, if I was going to leave a message like that, I would have written something like, go back, you plonker, but whatever works. With the help of Mickey and Jackie, they open the heart of the TARDIS with a big yellow truck, and Rose looks into the TARDIS, which sends her back, but also gives her, well, the power of a god. She destroys the Daleks and brings back Jack. Whether or not she brought back everyone else or rebuilt the Earth is left frustratingly unclear. This could be seen as a Deus Ex Machina, but I think this works really well. The Doctor didn't not have to make a decision like in Boomtown. He accepted his death and chose not to kill the Daleks, but then Rose came to save him. The decision had already been made, and also it's not like Rose killed the Daleks and then that was that. The energy she absorbed from the TARDIS is going to kill her, and the Doctor has to give his current life to stop that from happening, so it's not like it's consequence free like a conventional Deus Ex Machina.
The power's gonna kill you and it's my fault!
I can see everything. All that is. All that was. All that ever could be.
That's what I see. All the time. And doesn't it drive you mad?
My head.
Come here.
It's killing me.
I think you need a doctor.
But anyway, the Doctor kisses Rose, which I don't mind because it's for a plot-specific reason that isn't contrived, and she collapses in his arms. And when the Doctor stands back up with the time vortex in his eyes, chills, man, I got chills. The way he lets out a deep breath to return the energy back to the TARDIS is almost like he's taking all the responsibility and weight on his shoulders and just letting it all go. And with that, the day is saved.
So, after all of that, here's my conclusion.
The Parting of the Ways is masterful television, and after rewatching it for this review, it is the best episode of Season 1, hands down. It's a friggin' masterpiece. Everything that makes great entertainment is in this episode. Great storytelling, great script, great characters, a compelling conflict, stellar performances, great production values, a chilling threat, and it's just amazing all round. I'm in love with this episode. It's just incredibly well-assembled television that takes all the recurring themes and motifs of the past 10 stories and pays them off almost flawlessly, and I do love this episode, even if Rose is a bitch.
So there we go. That concludes my review of The Parting of the Ways. Thank you so much for waiting this long and for watching this far. I really appreciate it. Thanks for watching this video. Be sure to hit that subscribe button. Be sure to like this video. Leave a comment with your thoughts below. What did you guys and girls think of the episode? So thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Yeah, that's it. Review's over. that's the end. Yeah, nothing else. The day saved. Nothing else happens in this episode. Credits roll. It's done. Yeah. okay, I'll level with you guys. I don't want to talk about this scene. I didn't want him to go.
I've made it no secret that Christopher Eccleston was my Doctor, and he holds a special place in my heart as my first lead hero for my favourite TV show. My heart was broken as a casual viewer by his departure in 2005, and now, 9 years later, I have to revisit that as a critic. Eccleston was just magnificent in the role, but as much as it pains me to say this, it felt appropriate for him to leave now. His central story arc had been resolved. His regeneration is literally a rebirth for the character after everything that has happened. But damn it, I will still miss him.
Okay, I'll talk about his departure. And even though I didn't want him to go, I can't deny that this sequence was just perfectly done.
In my opinion, this is the best regeneration scene in the programme's history. Rose wakes up in the TARDIS confused as to what happened, but the Doctor knows his time is almost through.
Rose Tyler. I was going to take you to so many places. Barcelona? Not the city, Barcelona. The planet, Barcelona. You'd love it. Fantastic place. They've got dogs with no noses. Imagine how many times a day you end up telling that joke, and it's still funny.
Then why can't we go?
Maybe you will, and maybe I will, but not like this.
You're not making sense.
I might never make sense again. I might have two heads, or no head. Imagine me with no head. And don't say that's an improvement. But it's a bit dodgy, this process. You never know what you're going to end up with.
Don't stay away!
You see, Rose is in the same position as the audience who started watching 13 episodes ago. They may have no idea what is going on here, and the way the Doctor's lines are written is as if the Doctor understands that Rose will be scared and confused, but he's trying to make things easy for her and by proxy the audience. He explains simply what is going to happen and why it will be okay.
Tell me what's going on.
I absorbed all the energy of the time vortex, and no one's meant to do that. Every cell in my body's dying.
Can't you do something?
Yeah, I'm doing it now.
Time Lords have this little trick. It's sort of a way of cheating death. Except it means I'm going to change. And I'm not going to see you again. Not like this. Not with this daft old face.
He goes out with a smile, though. That's the most compelling thing about this scene. This is not a time for mourning. This is not a time for being sad. The Doctor is going to change his face, but he is okay with that. And as a result, the audience is okay with it too. There's no moping, no shouting, no tears of resentment. The Doctor is making things easy on Rose and on the audience by embracing the change. And that is what regeneration is all about. Goodbye, Christopher Eccleston. You were truly fantastic. I don't think we've had a Doctor as good as you since.
And before I go...
Don't say that!
Rose. Before I go, I just want to tell you, you were fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. And you know what? So was I.
And the regeneration itself is spectacular. It's an explosion of colour, almost violent in its power, but it's a fiery rebirth. And then, David Tennant, you handsome man, the future and the past is in safe hands with you.
Hello. Okay.
New teeth. That's weird. So where was I? Oh, that's right. Barcelona.
So there we go, that's it for my review for Sirius this time. So yeah, like I said, like, subscribe, leave a comment, share this video around with all your friends because it really helps me out. So there we go, that's Doctor Who Series 1 done, and if you don't mind, I have a little bit of unfinished business to take care of. This is going to be interesting. I'll see you guys next time.